ओम गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पतानः शृण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक्प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथोबलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि। सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्मनिराकुर्यां मा ब्रह्मनिराकरोत्। अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मेऽस्तु। तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु। ओम शांति शांति शांति। डियर फ्रेंड्स, वी आर रीडिंग द सेकंड मंत्र। वी आर इन द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द कमेंट्री ऑफ द सेकंड मंत्र। द सेकंड मंत्र वी नो दैट द उपनिषद इज सेइंग द thing which is behind the ear, the thing which is behind the eye, the thing which is behind the mind, and the thing which is behind the prana, that is what is supposed to be known. And what is that thing which is behind the mind? He calls it shrotra. Upanishad says it is shrotrasya shrotram, that is the ear of the ear. Manaso manaha, that is the mind of the mind. Chakshushas chakshuhu, that is the eye of the eye. The pranasya pranaha, the prana, the life force of the life force. So there is something which is behind. And then that is what is impelling all these things to do their functions. So that is what is the mantra saying. And then on that the discussion is going on. And there was a small purvapaksha. What do you mean when you say that shrotrasya shrotram? When you say ear behind the ear, where is the ear itself is intelligent? Ear itself is capable of hearing the shabda, knowing the shabda vishaya. Every indriya, every sense organ has its own sense vishaya, as you call it. Indriya vishaya. Indriya vishaya means the sense object. So eye is able to see. So this pen is an object for the eye. A sound is an object for the ear. Then taste is an object for the tongue. Then something else, some sparsha, that is the touch, it is the object for the sense of touch is the object for skin. So like that, there are five senses which are, you may say, each capable of knowing only one particular type of stimulus, isn't it? So all these things are cognized by the mind. So that is what we discussed in the last class also, that each sense corresponds to one of the five elements. So that is why each sense is able to cognize only one, whereas the mind consists of the sattvika tanmatra of all the five elements. So that is why mind is born or created out of the sattvika tanmatras of the five elements. So that is why mind is able to see all the five elements. So that is what we have seen earlier. So here, the Purvapakshi was asking, when you say Shrotrasya Shrotram, where is the need for one light to illumine another light? So on that there was a question, on that there was a reply. It is not so. This Shrotram, as you are saying, this Shrotram is independently not capable of cognizing anything. There is a need for something behind it. So that is where we are. And then the Shruti quoted some other lines. The Shruti initially said, Chaitanye Hyatma Jyotishi Nitye Asamhate Sarvantare Sati Bhavati. All these things, the Shrotram, Chakshu, all these things, they are part of an assemblage. And any assemblage is independently not intelligent. And an assemblage is for the purpose of somebody else. Any assemblage or a composite or an aggregate, it is only for the work of somebody else. Somebody else is using it. Suppose there is a machine. That machine will not work on its own. It has to be used by somebody else. So there is what is called Chaitanyam. That word Chaitanya has been used here. Chaitanye Hyatma Jyotishi Nitye Asamhate. Asamhata, we also saw that it is not part of that Sanghata. Sanghata is assemblage, Samhata is assembled. It is not assembled. It is not part of that assemblage, Chaitanya. And Chaitanya is something independent. And without that Chaitanya, neither the ear, nor the eye, the skin, they will not be able to see their sense, know their sense objects. So that is where we stop. And then the Shruti also quoted some other, lines from some other Upanishads. Atmanaivayam Jyotisha Aste. With this Atma Jyoti. Atma Jyoti means, Jyoti basically means a light. But here we should not take light in the physical sense, that which illumines, that which enables us to know. Illumine means that which enables us to know. So that is what it means. So then we also saw that Gita line, Yad Aditya Katam Tejaha Jagat Bhasayate Ekhilam. So that line we saw. And then we stopped at Kshetram Kshetri Tatha Krishnam Prakashayati Bharata. Because these words Kshetram and Kshetri we are supposed to understand. Of course, we have discussed these words in the Gita Bhashyam. But for those who have not heard Gita Bhashyam, though we have not covered the 13th chapter, here and there these two words appear, Kshetra and Kshetri, Kshetragnya. So, those words we discussed in the Gita Bhashya. But for those who have not heard the Gita Bhashyam, we have to discuss it here. So, this line is from the 13th, that is Kshetra Kshetragnya Vibhaga Yoga of Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita, we know, it consists of 18 chapters. The first 6 chapters talk about the Tvam Padartha, that is the Jiva. What is the, the being as such? That is the created being as we call it. Then the 7th and to 12th, they talk about the Dvitiya Shatkam, the second 6. They talk about this Tat Padartha. Tat means the Brahman. So what is the nature of Brahman? The nature of Brahman at 2 levels it talks. One is what is called the Sopadhika Brahma and the other is called Nirupadhika Brahma. Sopadhika Brahma means that which is associated with an Upadhi. So which we call a personal God at the religious level. Nirupadhika Brahma, where there is no such Upadhi, there is no such delimitation. You are talking about a pure consciousness which is unconnected with anything else. So that is that Sopadhika versus Nirupadhika. So these 2 levels are discussed between 7 and 12. So 13th through 18th, they talk about that equation between the Tat and Tvam. Because the ultimate Vedanta Vakya is, Mahavakya is Tat Tvam Asi, that thou art. When the Upanishad is saying that thou and art, so how is it that I am that? So the Bhagavad Gita, unconsciously there is a structure which has evolved in that. When Lord Krishna was giving that teaching to, imparting that teaching to, Arjuna, whenever a great master teaches something, even unconsciously, there will be a structure in that. You listen to any great master, he is conveying something. So when he conveys something, some certain things logically fall into place. So that is where we see that Tattvamasi Vakyam falling into place in these 18 chapters. The first 6 chapters talking about something, that is about the Jiva. The second 6 chapters talking about the Brahman. The last six chapters talking about that equation between this Tat and Tvam. So that is where, that is what we saw in Gita Bhashyam also. And this 13th chapter is the beginning of the third portion. The third portion means that is the last 6 chapters. So there is a discussion about what is Kshetram and what is Kshetri. Kshetram, what is the Kshetram? The general meaning of Kshetram is generally a field. It may be an agricultural field. Of course, Kshetram in Sanskrit, it has got several meanings. It also refers to wife. Kshetram, it also refers to wife. Wife and maybe one or two other meanings also. But the general meanings are, one is field and the other is a wife. And Kshetram, what is the particularity of the Kshetram? Peculiarity. Kshetram, you go, you cultivate and then you sow a seed and whatever you sow, accordingly you will reap, isn't it? So you do some karma and then according to your karma, you get your karma phala. That is what is karma kshetre kurukshetre, dharma kshetre kurukshetre. So this body, human body is a dharma kshetra or a karma kshetra. If you do dharma, it can be called dharma kshetra. If you do adharma, it can be called adharma kshetra, isn't it? So, if you sow seeds of dharma, you will reap dharma. If you sow seeds of adharma, you will get a harvest of adharma. And then if you don't sow any seed and if you are totally disconnecting yourself from the karma and then you are doing nishkama karma and if you are in that jnana path, you will dissociate from your, you will dissociate or distance yourself from this kshetram, and you become the observer of that kshetram. You become the observer of that kshetram. That observer of that kshetram is kshetrajna. Kshetram janati iti kshetrajna. Janati, he is an observer. And what are all this kshetram in this body? When you are talking about a physical kshetram, it is okay, it is identifiable. You leave your house, take your car and then go out and then go to your farmhouse, or you go to your farm which is outside the city or somewhere, that is your kshetram, where you put your trees, you cultivate and then you do some agriculture, what not, whatever it is. So that is your kshetram. And kshetram is not you, it may be yours, you may say it is mine, but kshetram is not you. But then Vedanta says this body is a kshetram. This body itself is kshetram. When you say that body is kshetram and there is some kshetrajna apart from that, then what do we imply? So that is what we have to see in the light of what all we studied earlier. In the light of all that we studied earlier, we have to see that this shrotrasya shrotram, when you say shrotrasya shrotram, shrotram is something which is there. Then the ear of the ear, so it must be something you. The ear of the ear must be that jnanam. Because Shrotram, what is this Shrotram actually creating? Shrotram is creating some impression in the mind. And it is just creating, that impression is in the form of a Chitta Vritti, isn't it? Chitta Vritti is, it is a mental, a frame of mind, let us say, a frame of mind at a particular time. A frame of mind at a particular time in response to a particular stimulus, let us say. A particular frame of mind at a time is called Chitta Vritti. And then suppose you hear a sound. That sound, it produces something, a sort of chitta vritti in your mind. You see something, the eye produces some chitta vritti in your mind. So the eye is something which can be distanced from you, isn't it? So when you, in the last class or so, we also discussed one story about how indriyas, they felt that they are supreme. And if I leave the body cannot survive, this fellow cannot survive. So the eye goes away for 1 year and comes back. The fellow is hale and healthy. The ear goes away for 1 year and then comes back. This fellow is hale and healthy. Similarly, the sense of touch goes away for 1 year. This fellow is hale and healthy. Ultimately, when the prana tries to go away, then they all say, no, don't go. But even that prana will be there only when Chaitanya is there. And unless Chaitanya is not, unless there is presence of Chaitanya, this prana also will not be there, isn't it? So that is what we saw. So when you say shrotrasya shrotram, it means, it implies that you can distance yourself from that shrotram. So then similarly, you can distance yourself from the I. You are not the I. The I, you may call it is my I, but you can distance yourself from that I. There is a very well known shloka from what is called Druk Drushya Viveka. In Druk Drushya Viveka by Vidyaranyamuni. Vidyaranyamuni, of course, Vidyaranya sage. Vidyaranya is a very well-known sage, very famous sage. He is one person, after Shankaracharya, he has produced such phenomenal, voluminous work in Vedanta. Shankaracharya, of course, he stands number one. He wrote Bhashyam, he wrote the commentary on Brahma Sutra, he wrote the commentary on all Upanishads, he wrote the commentary on Gita. He wrote several other Prakarana Grandhas. Prakarana Grandha means the basic text, the basic foundational text, let us say, on Vedanta. He wrote many hymns on so many gods and goddesses. He wrote so many things. And he also commented on Sanat Sujatiya. He commented on Vishnu Sahasranama. So there is a phenomenal work by Shankaracharya. And almost similar, volume is produced by, this Vidyaranya, sage Vidyaranya also, because he is the man who wrote the commentary on all the four Vedas. Today, the situation is that had Vidyaranya not written commentaries on all these four Vedas, we would be totally at a loss to find out what is the meaning of the Vedas. Because prior to Vidyaranya also, there were some commentators. Prior to Vidyaranya, because this Vedic language doesn't fit into, the classical Sanskrit. The Vedic Sanskrit we know is slightly different from classical Sanskrit. Classical Sanskrit means the Sanskrit of Panini. Panini himself is 2600 years old. 2600 years old. He lived somewhere in the present day Pakistan, somewhere near Lahore. Some people say that is somewhere on the border of Afghanistan. I am not very sure. But anyway, he is about 2600 years old. And prior to Panini also the Sanskrit, classical Sanskrit was there. So when you talk about Vedic language, you are talking about some 5000 year old Sanskrit. And some of the portions of this Veda, they do not fall into this this grammar of this classical Sanskrit, so which is very difficult unless there is an interpreter. So there was that living tradition till almost recently, that living tradition of understanding Veda, it was there till recently. Now of course it has become so weak that it is almost imperceptible. Very very rarely, maybe in the entire state of Andhra Pradesh, maybe about hardly a dozen people may be capable of teaching that Bhashyam, Veda Bhashyam. So who have learned in that Guru Parampara, and then who can teach? Of course, simply by knowing Sanskrit and by reading Vidyaranya, one may be tempted to teach, or tempted to know, say that I know. But then we have to know it in the tradition, because Veda involves so many things. Veda involves Veda Anga. Veda Anga means Shiksha, Vyakaranam, Chandas, Nirukta and what not. So all those things, unless you know traditionally, you will not understand. You may know the dictionary meaning of something, but you will not know the whole implication of what is that astronomical significance, what is the significance of some other Mimamsa significance. All these things you will not be able to know. Okay, anyway, we'll leave it like that. Coming back to Vidyaranya, Vidyaranya has written a book called Vidruk Drushya Viveka. He wrote several books. He is very analytical in his approach. What we see in Vidyaranya is, he is very analytical in his approach. He also wrote another book called Jivan Mukti Viveka. Viveka itself is analysis. Viveka is again an analysis, discriminating. When things are mixed up, you are supposed to differentiate. When all things are mixed up, and when there is a confused state of affairs, somebody who with a sane head has to come, sit there and then sort out all things, isn't it? So that is called Viveka. So that is differentiating. Normally we say discrimination. So Druk Drushya Viveka, Jivan Mukti Viveka. So here Druk and Drushya, he is the same as Kshetri and Kshetram. So this in Vedanta we come across these words. Kshetram is something which can be distanced from what I can say I. So when I talk about the Shrotram, coming back to that Shrotram discussion, I can distance myself from that ear. I can distance myself from that eye. I can distance myself from the sense of touch. I can distance myself from the sense of taste. And that is at the Indriya level. So there is this, what Vidyaranya says is, there is a shloka, Rupam Drushyam Lochanam Druk. You need not write that shloka. Rupam Drushyam Lochanam Druk. Rupam means whatever we see with the eye, that is a Rupam. There is a shape. That shape or color is that Drushyam. It is called Drushyam, that which is seen. That is also called Kshetram. Whatever is seen is Drushyam. It is also called Kshetram. All these synonyms you may note down. Kshetram is the same as Drushyam. It is the same as the Rupam. That is a common thing. Rupam, Shabdam and all these things, they are Vishayas. Rupam, Shabdam, etc. are Vishayas. Kshetram is Drushyam. In Vedanta, we also call it Anatma. You can also note it Anatma. And you also call it Prakruti. You also call it Jada, insentient. Jada means insentient. And you also call it Apara Prakruti, Apara. In the 7th chapter of Gita, we have come across two words called Para Prakruti and Apara Prakruti. Apara means the lower level of Prakruti. Para is the higher level of Prakruti. So all these words are synonyms for Kshetra. For Kshetrajna, Kshetrajna is the field knower, let us say. So that is this, in this line it is called Kshetri. Here in the Gita line, Kshetri. Kshetri is the same as Kshetrajna. Kshetrajna is equal to Kshetri. It is also called Druk. It is also called Atma. It is also called Purusha, because Purusha versus Prakriti, that is the Sankhya terminology. And it is also called Para Prakriti versus Apara Prakriti, that is Kshetram. So these are the synonyms for Kshetram and Kshetri. Kshetri is the same as Kshetrajna. And Kshetram is called Drushyam, whatever is seen. So Drupam Drushyam, Lochanam Druk, that is the first level. Lochanam means eye. Lochanam is eye. So Lochanam is Druk. Druk means the seer, the observer, the knower. The knower is the, say, Lochanam, eye. But this eye itself can be observed by the mind, isn't it? I can think about my eye, I can think about my ear, I can think about my skin, I can think about all my sense organs. So, tat drushyam druktu manasam. That is, the lochanam itself becomes drushyam. Initially, that was the first level of knower. But, that itself becomes a drushyam, known or observed with reference to mind. And mind again becomes the observed with reference to buddhi. Mind itself can be thought of, it can be distanced, and then this buddhi, the intellect, it becomes the observer. And then this buddhi is illumined by what is called Sakshi. Sakshi Chaitanya. That Sakshi is nothing but Chaitanya, Shuddha Chaitanya. Sakshi, the meaning of Sakshi is witness. It does not mean that there is somebody sitting somewhere in the heart, somewhere in Buddhi Guha, we say. Hrudaya Guha, we say. Vedanta uses the term Hrudaya. And in Vedanta, we should never assume that Hrudaya refers to heart, not the physical heart, Buddhi Guha. Whenever Vedanta says Hrudaya Granthi, it is referring to Buddhi Granthi. Hrudaya in Vedanta is Buddhi. So, in Buddhi, somewhere in that Akasha, in this so-called mind space, in that mind space, somewhere this some small light is there, some small lamp-like thing is there, some sort of Atman is there, or some sort of Sakshi or witness is there. We should not assume in that manner. So, this Sakshi is something which is of the nature of pure Chaitanya or consciousness, which is reflecting in that Antahkarana. And according to Vedanta, this mind, Buddhi, is an excellent reflecting medium for that Chaitanya. And because of this great reflection, that all this, the mind is working, the sense organs are working. So that is what we have to see. So here when we see, Kshetram Kshetri Tatha Krishnam Prakashayati Bharata. Bharata means, hey Bharata, hey Arjuna. Krishna is telling Arjuna here. Kshetri, that is the subject in this line, Kshetri, that is Kshetrajna, that is the Chaitanyam, let us say concretely without any confusion, Kshetri is Kshetrajna, it is referring to Chaitanyam. Kshetri, tatha, likewise, Krushnam Kshetram Prakashayati. Krushnam Kshetram means the entire field. Entire field means not only this body. What all you see in the universe, what all your senses cognize, all the five senses, after all we have five senses only. With these five senses we do cognize so many things. And what all you cognize in this universe, with the help of science, without the help of science, whatever it is, science adds some gadgets to you. It may give you a telescope. Telescope is only an addition to the eye, isn't it? And you take a microscope. Microscope also is an addition to the eye. Or you find some other sensor, that particular sensor is only an addition to another sense organ, isn't it? Whatever sensors you may use, they are additions to your own sense organs. So, with the help of science or without the help of science, whatever you cognize, it becomes drushyam. And this consciousness which is behind everything, it is the druk. And when you say Sakshi is not a person. Sakshi is Shuddha Chaitanyam. It is of the nature of consciousness. It is not somebody who is witnessing all your right deeds or wrong deeds and then writing down notes and whatnot. We should not think in that fashion. So anyway, then the Dhivruttaya Sakshi Drugeva. That is what Vidyaranya says. Anyway, coming back to this Gita line, Kshetri, that is Kshetrajna, he is the person who is not person, that is the entity which is illumining, Prakashayati. The meaning of Prakashayati means, that is enabling it to know, Prakashayati. Literal meaning of Prakashayati means it illumines. It does. It is not as though there is some torchlight putting on the intellect, antahkarana. That chaitanya is there associated with this antahkarana, and with that association, this antahkarana is able to know various things. Prakashayati. Prakashayati means the very existence and the very intelligence of this antahkarana is that of that Shuddha Chaitanya. So that is what it means. So is this line clear?
Yes.
Kshetri. Krutsnam Kshetram Prakashayati. So that is how it that is the construction there. The first line is what is that first line? Kshetrajnam Japimam Vidhi Rupam Kshetrajnam. There is a first line also. Yatha Prakashayate Yekaha Krutsnam Lokam Imam Ravihi. This is the 33rd sloka in 13th Adhyaya of Gita. The first line is यथा प्रकाशयत् एकः कृत्स्नं लोकमिमं रविः. Just as the sun is illumining the whole universe, and then he is untouched by all this dirt of this universe. That is what also we saw in Kathopanishad. The sun is merely illumining. He is illumining so many things, all dirty things, good things, and all those things. But then he is not touched by any of these things. So similarly, this Kshetri is giving this sustenance to this Kshetram, but untouched. So that is again that untouched is very important here. Just as the sun is untouched by all these things, the Kshetrajna is untouched by all these things. So that is what we have to see. Then Iticha Gitasu. Then let us see Kathakecha
Nityo Nityanam
Chetanas Chetananam
Iti.
So here, of course, here this Patan, this the quotation given is Nityo Nityanam. So if you break it, Nityaha Nityanam. But then if you see Kathopanishad, Shankaracharya has taken the version as Nityo Anityanam. Nityaha Anityanam. Chetanaha Chetananam. So Anityanam means among the impermanent things, this is the permanent thing. So that is what we have, that is what Shankaracharya version is there. So if you take, it is safer to take it that way. If you take it that way, so Nityaha Anityanam, what is that Nitya and what is that Anitya? So Anitya is all the things which are perishing, they are all Anitya. And then when he is there, Shankaracharya is referring to the entire Srushti. The entire Srushti is again, it gets resolved into that Srushti Karta or the Creator Brahman. And that Creator Brahman himself gets resolved into Maya, isn't it? So we know that this Maya is an expression in that Supreme Consciousness. And in this Maya, there are so many chains, so many cycles of creation. And each cycle of creation, you say that particular cosmic function which is called creation, you are giving it a name, calling it Srushtikarta. So that Srushtikarta also gets resolved. Once that cycle is over, isn't it?
Yes.
So that particular Srushti Karta also is getting dissolved. So though up to that level they are all Anitya. Up to the level of Srushti Karta, they are all Anitya. So when all these things get resolved, then what is it that is still remaining? The karma of the beings, all the karma of all these beings, it is there in that seed form, in the form of a bija. Bijam mam sarva bhutanam, that is bijam, that is what we saw when all these things perish. But the karma which is done by these people or by all the beings, that is there in the form of a bijam. And then because of that, again depending on their karma, they are again created in the next cycle. Because in the next cycle, somebody may be born rich, somebody may be born poor. So that, which means that we should not attribute any sort of partiality to the God or the Creator. Creator has no partiality, he has no favoritism, he doesn't like some people, he doesn't dislike some people, he doesn't hate some people. So when there is inequality in the creation, so it only means that this inequality is because of the past, whatever was that karma. We attribute it to karma. So when all these things are getting resolved back into Maya, still, what is remaining? That Chaitanyam is still remaining. Chaitanyam is always remaining. Not still remaining, it is always remaining. So that is why it is called Nityaha Anityanam. Then Chetanas Chetananam. Chetanaha, you find different levels of Chetanas. Chetana means those people, so they are the people which illumine others. For example, Surya, sun is supposed to illumine. The moon, Chandra is supposed to illumine. So all these are supposed to be Chaitanas. But then they are again deriving their Chaitanyam from the Supreme Being only. So Chaitanas Chaitananam, he is the illuminer of all other illuminers. He is the force behind all other illumining forces. So that is how that word was interpreted there in Kathopanishad. Nityaha Anityanam Chaitanas Chaitananam. So but then anyway, here in this quotation, and also I saw that say a book edited by S.S. Shastri, that is Mahesh Research Institute, that is supposed to be a very standard work. There also this Nityo Nityanam, it is mentioned there. I have not seen Gambhirananda text. I don't know what text he has taken. Anyway, Nityo Nityas Chetanas Chetananam Iti. So then next, Shrotradyeva Sarvasya Atmabhutam Chetanam Iti Prasiddham.
Sarvasya Atmabhutam Chetanam Iti Prasiddham.
Tad Iha Nivartyate. So Shrotradyeva Sarvasya Atmabhutam Chetanam Iti Prasiddham. What Prasiddham means? That which is commonly accepted, that it is well known in this world. What is well known? Shrotradi eva atmabhutam chetanam. What you call it as senses, ear, eye, all these senses, they themselves are chetanam, they themselves are sentient. So this is what people generally understand, isn't it? That is what people understand. Sarvasya atmabhutam, that is the atma, that is the chetanam, iti prasiddham. But then, tat iha nivartyate, that is being refuted here. Nivartyate means, it is being refuted. So that is what it means. Nivartyate, asti kimapi,
vidvad buddhigamyam,
sarvantaratamam. Kutastham ajam ajaram.
Amrutam abhayam.
Shrotradirapi shrotradi. Tat samarthya nimittam. Iti prativachanam. Shabdarthascha upapadyate eva. So we have to jolly well accept that there is something behind all these things. Asti kimapi, there is something. Kimapi, something. There is something. Asti kimapi, there is something. Then to whom is it known? Vidvad buddhi gocharam means only it is known only to some thinking persons. It is not like king's new clothes. We should not make fun of it saying that it is something like king's new clothes. It is something which is known to somebody who can discriminate. If you do not want to discriminate, you will never know. You will never understand it. But if you do discriminate, if you see what is your real nature, who exactly am I? Am I only this body, mind and senses? Or am I something different? What is the thing which is really behind me? What is the thing which is really, what can be called I? I is something which can never be negated. Suppose my ear is not there, even if ear is not there, my eye exists, isn't it? Even if hand is not there, or leg is not there, or even if some other sense is not there, the so-called I exists. So this I exists even if mind is not there. Even if mind is not there, the notion will be there. Mind, he may become a mad fellow, but even then this I will be there. So this, nobody will have a feeling that I don't exist. Nobody can ever have the notion I don't exist, isn't it? So that I is that Shuddha Chaitanya, which is totally not refutable, which cannot be negated, which cannot be refuted at any time. So vidvad buddhi gamyam. So for that you have to do some discrimination, you have to analyze, you have to do some chintanam also. It is very easy to say Shrotradau Atma Buddhi Tyaktavya, we saw in the last class. So you have to leave this Atma Buddhi in the ear, eyes and all these things. It is very difficult. That is why Vedanta says, okay, we are saying something, but then you are supposed to think on that, you are supposed to meditate on that, you are supposed to internalize it, and you are supposed to feel it. So Vedanta aims at some internal transformation. by way of this sort of meditation, isn't it? All these things we are supposed to meditate, mananam. Meditate means not meditating on God form, that upa, not in the sense of upasana, in the sense of mananam and nididhyasanam. So mananam and nididhyasanam only are supposed to transform us internally. So anyway, kimapi vidvad buddhi gamyam sarvantaratamam, that which is indwelling all, sarva antaratamam, antara means inside, sarvantaratamam, the most, the deepest part, that most deepest part means the most subtle thing which is there, which is say enlivening everything. Then kutastham ajam ajaram. Kutastha, this word we have come across, kutastha. Kuta is the anvil of an iron smith. An iron smith has a big anvil there on which he beats up all things and then brings them into shape. So all these things which are heated up and then kept in on the anvil, and then he takes a hammer and hammers them. So the hammer doesn't change and the anvil does not change. Then this thing which is heated up, that changes its shape. So the anvil is called kuta. Kutastha means something which is unchanging, which never undergoes any change. So this consciousness is something which never undergoes any change. This the cycle of creation may come and go. The human beings, they come and go. Not only human beings, the very cycles of creation may come and go, but all these things, they are appearances in the Chaitanya. The Chaitanya is the Adhishthanam. Adhishthanam means that which is the base, that which is the support for all these things, and then that is always there. Kutastham ajam. Ajam is something which is not born. Chaitanya is not something which is born, because if you say something is born, you are talking about a time frame. And in that time, for when you say that it is born at that particular time and it was not there at the particular time, there should be somebody to say that it was not there at that particular time. And that somebody should have that intelligence. And that intelligence itself is what we call Chaitanyam. So that intelligence is what is called Ajam. Then Ajara, it never decays. It never decays. Ajara, Jara is old age. That means Ajara means it never decays. Amrutam Abhayam. Amrutam. Amrutam means it never disappears. There is no mruti. It never disappears. Abhayam. Abhayam is another concept which we see in Vedanta. Abhaya is, that is, there is a well-known saying which you have to know. Dvitiya Dvaibhayam. That is, when you see difference, not difference in the sense, when you see diversity, when you see yourself, I gave an example from one Swamiji, Akhandananda Swamiji, he gives an example. If you consider yourself a particular sect of Brahmin, you are excluding yourself from all other Brahmins. When you identify yourself as a Brahmin only, you are excluding yourself from the rest of the society. If you are calling yourself a Hindu, you are excluding yourself from Christians, Muslims and all other people. If you are calling yourself a human being, you are excluding yourself from this all other, all the beings which are created along with you. So like that, you are delimiting yourself. So this, and when you identify yourself as this and not that, then you always have some apprehension. This Pakistan fellow may conduct a raid on us. He may attack us. You are an Indian and there is a Pakistani or some other Chinese man. So this Chinese man or a Pakistan man can attack. So this difference, feeling of the perception of duality. I am just giving a very, very simple example. This example is not applicable to soldiers on the border. This particular example is applicable only for a student of Vedanta. Only for a student of Vedanta who wants to know the absolute reality, who wants to see from that God's point of view, God or Brahman's point of view. Above God is Brahman, isn't it? So, if you are sitting at Brahman's point of view, from Brahman's point of view, you are something of the nature of Brahman only. You are Brahman only, and then for Brahman, there is no question of difference between Pakistani and Hindu or whatever it is. So, we are not talking about the soldier at the border or the policymaker or a diplomat or some other strategist. We are talking from the point of view of a Vedanti. So, this is Abhayam, is fearlessness. Fearlessness means only when you see something which is different from you, then there is an apprehension. that I am something different and that is something different. So when you are yourself the infinite, when you are the infinite, all those things are in you. Chinese fellow is in you, Pakistani fellow is in you, some other man is in you, everybody is in you, everything is in you. So when you are in that, identifying yourself with that Brahman, there is no question of fear. So that is why it is called Abhayam. So that is that level. Then Shrotradi Rapi Shrotradi. So this is the ear of the ear. Tat Samarthya Nimittam. So Tat Samarthya Nimittam means that is the cause. Nimittam means cause. That is the cause for the Samarthyam, that is ability of all these things. Tat Samarthya Nimittam means the cause or the source for the ability of all these things. The source for the ability or power of all these things. Tat Samarthya Nimittam iti Prativachanam Shabdarthasya Upapadyate Eva. So this thing, this Prativachanam means reply. This reply is very, very appropriate. Then Tatha Manasaha Antahkaranasya Manaha.
Manasaha Antahkaranasya Manaha.
Nahi Antahkaranam.
Nahi Antahkaranam.
Antarena Chaitanya Jyotisha.
Antarena
Chaitanya Jyotisha Deepitam.
Chaitanya Jyotisha Deepitam.
Svavishaya.
Svavishaya.
Sankalpa Adhyavasayadi Samartham Syat.
Sankalpa Adhyavasayadi Samartham Syat.
Okay, he is now talking about the mind. So you have now, earlier you have talked about the indriyas. All these indriyas, their position has been shown. Then what is the position of this mind? Mind also is like that. Tatha manasaha antahkaranasya manaha. Manasaha manaha. It is the mind of the mind. It is the illuminer of that mind. What is that? Nahi antahkaranam antarena chaitanya jyotisha deepitam. Chaitanya Jyotisha Deepitam means something which is Deepitam. We know Deepam. Deepam is lamp, light. Something which is lit, let us say, or something which is illumined by Chaitanya Jyoti, by the lamp of Chaitanya. Chaitanya is again figuratively called a Jyoti. Chaitanya Jyotisha Deepitam. That which is illumined by the lamp of Chaitanya, by the lamp of consciousness. This mind also will not function unless it is illumined by the lamp called consciousness. So that is what it is. Antarena. Antarena means unless. Antarena is antarena, tam antarena. That is without that. So in that sense. Antarena chaitanya jyotisha deepitam. Unless it is illumined by this light called consciousness. Svavishaya. Samartham bhavati, samartham syat, svavishaya samartham, that is svavishaya grahana samartham, that is it will not become capable of, it will not be capable of knowing its object. What are those things? What does the mind do? Sankalpa adhyavasayadi samartham syat. Mind does this sankalpa and adhyavasaya. We know these two sentences, two words, sankalpa and adhyavasaya. Sankalpa is an impression gets registered in the mind. And then the mind is still undetermined about what it is. So that indeterminate level is called sankalpa. And in fact, the mind itself is said to function at four levels. Vedanta analyzes mind at four levels. We know that. Mano buddhi ahankara chittani naham. So that is what that line. Manas, buddhi, ahankara and chittam. These are the four levels. Of course, you have seen in Gita Bhashya. But for somebody who is listening to Keno Upanishad, this may not be known. Manas is when the sense organs bring these sense impressions and then record them in the mind. That first initial stage of recording, and then the mind has not decided or determined as to what it is. So that is that level of manas. That is what is called mind. In English, of course, generally we use the word mind. But in Vedanta, there is a clear classification between these four. So that first recording level is called the mind. Then there is another level called buddhi. Buddhi is, that is, then you decide, oh yes, this it is. Yeah, this is something which I like. This is something which I do not like. This is something which is desirable and something not desirable. So that is what is a decision. So that decision making, that is adhyavasaya, it is called adhyavasaya. That decision making level is called buddhi. So this mind, antahkaranam is the general word used for all the four levels. Antahkaranam. Antaha means inside, karanam is tool. the inside tool, that is the mind, the mind in all four levels. So this sankalpa level is called manas, adhyavasaya level is called buddhi, then there is what is called aham. Okay, then I, the notion of I, yes, I know that, I have it, I want to have it, I enjoyed it, I liked it. So that is that level called I, where this I comes into being, that is called ahamkara. Ahamkara in Vedanta does not mean arrogance. Ahamkara normally in normal parlance, we use it as arrogance. But here in Vedanta, it doesn't refer to arrogance. It refers to this notion of I. Then that is ahankara level. Then there is another level where after all this experience is over, at some later date, at some later time, maybe after a couple of days, maybe after a couple of years, after many years, you just recall all that experience. That is called, that recalling faculty is called chittam. So manas, buddhi, ahankara and chittam. So here all these things will not be possible unless it is, unless this antahkarana is illumined by say the chaitanya. So in this mantra, when it says shrotrasya shrotram manaso manoyat, you are not referring to that mind level, manas level only, you are referring to all the four levels, mana, buddhi, ahankara and chittam, all the four levels. Just as when you refer to shrotra, you are referring to all indriyas, and then when you refer to walk, you are referring to all karmendriyas. When you are referring to manas, you are referring to all levels of mind, that is manas, buddhi, ahankara and chittam. So here adhyavasayadi lakshanam samartham syat. Is it clear?
Yes.
Tasmat manasopi mana iti.
Manasopi mana iti.
Manasaha api manaha. Manasaha means of the mind. This is the mind of the mind. That is something which is behind it or something which is illuminating it. Then iha buddhi manasi.
Buddhi manasi.
Eki kurtya nirdeshaha.
Eki kurtya nirdeshaha.
Manasa iti.
Manasa iti.
So Shankaracharya, for our understanding, he is also clarifying, saying that here, iha means here, buddhi manasi eki krutya, by combinedly referring to buddhi and manas. Buddhi and manas have been combinedly, jointly referred here by the word manas. So that is what he says, eki krutya, that is bringing together in one place. Nirdeshaha means designating it or calling it manasa iti. Then next line. Yad vachoha vacham.
Yad vachoha vacham.
So we are coming to the next word. Yad vachoha vacham. Yad shabdaha.
Yad shabdaha.
Yasmadarthe.
Yasmadarthe.
Shrotradivis sarvais sambadhyate.
Shrotradivis sarvais sambadhyate.
Okay. This yad vachoha vacham. A walk. Walk is what sort of indriya is it? It is what is called a karmendriya. We know that there are what are called jnanendriyas, that is the sense organs, and there are what are called karmendriyas. Karmendriyas are the motor organs. Suppose I see a thing. So this eye is the karmendriya, jnanendriya. That is, it has brought some knowledge or jnanam or information to the mind, isn't it? Then some desire arises in me. I want to go and get it. So this gives an order to my feet. So this feet goes, the legs go there and then try to get it. So this leg is a karmendriya, hand is a karmendriya, walk is a karmendriya. I go and do some talk and try to get it. Though this, when I do some talking, it is this karmendriya. So all these karmendriyas, they are like subordinates to jnanendriyas. So jnanendriya is the boss and karmendriya is the subordinate. So that is their structure, isn't it? So this karmendriya, where you are referring to this yad vachoha vacham. So yat shabdaha, that is that word yat, yasmadarthe prayuktaha. Yasmadarthe. Yasmat means because yat. Here the word yat means yasmat. Sarvais shrotradhivi sambadhyate. With all other things also it connects in the same manner. That is, because it is shrotrasya shrotram, because it is manasaha manasa, because it is vachoha vacham, because it is the voice of the speech behind the speech. So that is how we have to connect it like that. Yasman manaso manasa ityevam vachoha vachamiti.
Vachoha vachamiti.
Vachoha vachamiti dvitiya.
Vachoha.
So this up to this. Yasmat manaso manasaha ityevam. So likewise, you have to take it because it is manasaha manaha. Because it is mind of the mind, because it is ear of the ear, because it is eye of the eye. So that is how we have to connect with all those things. You have to take that yat shabda has to connect. Then he is coming to another word. वाचोह वाचम
वाचोह वाचम
इति द्वितीय
इति द्वितीय
प्रथमात्वेन विपरिणमते विपरिणम्यते. सो यू सी दिस मंत्र कमिंग बैक टू दिस मंत्र श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रम. सो यू सी द वर्ड्स श्रोत्रस्य इन विच विभक्ति इज इट श्रोत्रस्य इट इज इन षष्ठी विभक्ति. वेरी गुड. श्रोत्रम प्रथम विभक्ति श्रोत्रम इज से द न्यूट्रल जेंडर इट इज सो प्रथम विभक्ति. देन मनसो मनः मनसः मनः मनसः इज इन षष्ठी विभक्ति दैट इज पॉसेसिव केस. देन अगेन मनः इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस. मनः इज अगेन नपुंसकलिंग दो मनस इट इट साउंड्स लाइक ए पुंलिंग इट इज एक्चुअली नपुं मनस मनस शब्द मनस इज नपुंसकलिंग दैट इज न्यूट्रल जेंडर. सो मनसो मनः दिस मनस आल्सो इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस. देन वाचोह वाचम वाचः ऑफ द वर्क वाचम इज इन फेमिनाइन इज इन द ऑब्जेक्टिव केस. दिस इज द ओनली वर्ड विच इज इन द ऑब्जेक्टिव केस. देन द नेक्स्ट वन इज प्राणस्य प्राणः प्राणस्य इज इन पोसेसिव केस प्राणः इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस. इन ऑल अदर प्लेसेस दिस ऐ ऑफ द ऐ द इयर ऑफ द इयर एट्सेट्रा ऑल दोस थिंग्स द सेकेंड थिंग द फर्स्ट थिंग ऐ इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस. ऐ ऑफ द ऐ ऐ ऐ ऐ ऑफ ऐ ऑफ द ऐ द सेकेंड से थिंग इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस इज इट. श्रोत्रस्य इज पोसेसिव केस श्रोत्रम इज इन नॉमिनेटिव केस. So in all other places, one is in possessive case and the other is in nominative case. Only here when you say vachoha vacham, this vacham is in the next thing, nominative objective case. That is dvitiya vibhakti. It is in dvitiya vibhakti. Vacham is in dvitiya vibhakti. For example, vacham dhenam upasita, vacham upasita. So you have to do upasana of vak. So that is how it is in nominative, it is in objective case. So this objective case should be converted to changed to prathama vibhakti. So that is what he says, because by the force of all other words, by the predominance of expression in all other words, you have to convert this dvitiya vibhakti into prathama vibhakti. So that is what it means. Is it clear? When you see all these sentences in the mantra, it is very very clear. It is basically a small grammatical point, that's all. वाचोह वाचमिति द्वितीय प्रथमात्वेन विपरिणम्यते. विपरिणम्यते मीन्स इट हैज टू बी कन्वर्टेड इन दट मैनर इट गेट्स चेंज इन दट मैनर. देन प्राणस्य प्राण इति दर्शनात्. सो बिकॉज इन ऑल अदर प्लेसेस प्राणस्य प्राणः चक्षुषस्य चक्षुः श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रम्. सो इन वन थिंग इज इन पोसेसिव एंड वन थिंग इज इन नॉमिनेटिव. सो बाय द प्रेडोमिनेंस ऑफ ऑल अदर थिंग्स इट हैज टू बी कन्वर्टेड लाइक दैट. Then somebody can put a question. What is this? Vachoha vachamiti.
Vachoha vachamiti.
Ityetad anurodhena.
Ityetad anurodhena.
Pranasya pranamiti.
Pranasya pranamiti.
Kasmat dvitiyaiva na kriyate.
Kasmat dvitiyaiva na kriyate.
So somebody can question. Okay, why not take vachoha vacham as standard? Vachoha vacham only will take. And why don't you say pranasya pranam instead of saying pranasya pranaha? Pranasya pranaha is prana is in nominative case. Instead of putting it in nominative case, why don't you put in the objective case? Why don't you say pranasya pranam? It doesn't mean anything. So the questioner is asking it. Pranasya pranam iti kasmat dvitiyaiva na kriyate. Why not you change the others into dvitiya? Why should you change this one into prathama vibhakti? And why not you change the others into dvitiya? So he says, then no, it is not like that. Because of the predominance in usage in that particular line, you have to see the overall force of all the sentence, overall force of the sentence, and then convert this thing into prathama vibhakti or nominative case. So that is what he says. Na bahunam anurodhasya yuktatvat. Yukta, what is appropriate? Yuktam means that what is appropriate, that which is appropriate. What is it? Bahunam anurodhasya yuktatvat. Anurodha, the force of all other things, bahunam, of several things, the majority, the force of majority applies here. Let us say the force of majority appears to be a better word. Bahunam anurodhah. Where is this word? Bahunam anurodhah. Hmm. force of bahunam, the force of majority, it would be proper. That is the predominance in usage or the force of majority. It is in that manner. Bahunam anurodhasya yuktatvat. Yukta means appropriate.
Vacham ityasya vak ityetavad vaktavyam.
Sa u pranasya prana iti. Shabdadvayanurodhena. Evam hi bahunam anurodho yuktaha. Krutaha syat. So he says, bahunam anurodhasya yuktatvat. You go as per the majority of the sentences there. Then vacham ityasya vak ityetavad vaktavyam. So instead of saying vacham, that is in dvitiya vibhakti, you have to say only vak. Vachoha vak, it should have been vachoha vak. Instead of being using vachoha vak, the Upanishad said vachoha vacham. Not that the Upanishad, the Rishi did not know, but somehow in the Upanishads we don't find say 100% grammatical accuracy. Sometimes they took some liberty or license, we do not know. Or maybe we do not know some earlier significance, we do not know. But Sri Shankaracharya also has not noted anything. He says vachoha vacham should be taken as vachoha vak. So vacham ityasya vak ityetavad vaktavyam. Etavad means only this much. Etavat is only this much. That is vak iti vaktavyam. Because savu pranasya prana iti shabdadvayanurodhena. Savu, that only is pranasya pranaha. The next line also is coming as pranasya pranaha. The fourth life force of the life force. Evam hi, likewise, bahunam anurodha yuktaha krutasyat. So you are following the majority. So that is what it means. So here, of course, some grammatical discussion on grammar was there. Then, prushtam cha vastu.
Prathama yaiva nirdeshtum yuktam.
So that is in continuation of the earlier thing. Prushtam cha vastu. So whatever has been asked for, whatever has been asked by the questioner. The questioner, he said, what is the question? Kena eshitam patati preshitam manaha. Kena prana prathama praityuktaha. By whom desired, by whom impelled. So when we say by whom has he been directed. So the reply will be by X, by Y. So this X and Y are in nominative case only and not in objective case. So that is what it means. Prushtam cha vastu prathamaya eva nirdeshtum yuktam. It is proper to designate that in nominative case only, because the question is like that. Depending on the question, you have to give reply in prathama vibhakti only. So that is what it means. Sa yaha tvaya prushtaha.
Pranasya pranakhya vrutti visheshasya prana tat kritam hi pranasya pranana samarthyam.
Okay, sa yaha tvaya prushtaha, that which has been asked by you. You means here you are going to that fundamental, the first questioner, kena eshitam patati preshitam mana, the student who asked the guru. So you are going back to the student. So yahasa yaha tvaya prushtaha, that which has been asked by you, means by the student. What is that? Pranasya pranaha. Pranasya, what is the meaning of prana? He is explaining prana is pranakhya vrutti visheshasya. Pranakhya vrutti vishesha. Prana again is a sort of vrutti. Vrutti is means a particular function. Prana is, that is, you are inhaling the life force, you are inhaling the air, you are inhaling, and then this air you are inhaling is having some five functions: prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. These are the five functions which are taking place in the body. Of course, we have heard about it in Gita Bhashya also. Prana is that which taken in. Apana is that which is going out. So of course there is a small confusion between prana and apana. Some people say that apana is something which goes out and prana is something which is taken in. Apana is something which is taken in and prana is something which is goes out. So, but then it depends on whether you are talking about yoga or whether you are talking about Vedanta. then there is what is called samana. That is that particular function of the air which keeps pressure equal in the whole body. That is called samana. Then vyana is sarva shariragaha. Samana is at the nabhi, that is at the navel. Vyana is something which is all over the body. So like that, this air has different functions in the body, and then these different functions are given different names. Anyway, we need not bother about them. Pranakhya vritti vishesha. Vritti means a particular function only. Prana is a particular function. So pranasya pranaha, then what is that, what is it that is impelling that prana? Tatkrutam hi pranasya pranana samarthyam. Tatkrutam means unless that atma chaitanyam is there, unless the working of that atma chaitanya is there, this pranasya pranana samarthyam will not be there. Prananam, prananam means that is breathing or this life force, as we call it. This prana also, you have to see the word pra plus ana. Pra plus ana is prana. Apa plus ana is apana. V plus a plus ana is vyana. Then samana, sama plus ana is samana. So like that, ana is what in English we call ana is that life force. In the word animal also, that life force is there. That is the same root is there. So pranaha, tatkurtam hi pranasya pranana samarthyam. Is the time over?
Yes.
Huh? Oh, it's over. So we'll see in the next class. Today is 29th. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.